Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God. To the saints who are at Ephesus and who are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
I actually had a hard time getting my wife here tonight. And don't laugh, Jeff told me the same thing. And Steve, your wife isn't here. Well, in the next 2 weeks, we're going to be considering what I believe to be two of the most misunderstood and abused subjects in all of Scripture: a wife's submission to her husband. I've heard about it for 50 years. That's why I said misunderstood. And secondly, a husband's love for his wife. That will be our subject next week. So, you wives were faithful to come tonight, and your husbands and boyfriends will be faithful to come next week. And let me make a couple other introductory comments. Let's remember again, as we talk tonight about what makes for a 50-year marriage. Some of us don't have the chance at that. We're in our second marriage. Some of us are going to say tonight, I wish I'd have known this much earlier in life. Here's a real huge peace of mind. If God wanted you to know it, you would have known it. We're all going to spend eternity with Him. The Apostle Paul told us something wonderful in Philippians chapter 3. He said, he always forgot what's behind him, and he looked forward to what lies ahead. I always understand and encourage you to understand God's word in terms of helping you from here forward. The purpose of God's word is never to put a guilt trip on believers about the past. Past is the past. It's all under Christ's blood. It's all been graced. Praise God for His grace and mercy. It's always to help us today. So some of us have been married 10, 15 years, 20 years. This will help us tonight and tomorrow. It was great for me to make this new study. Let me suggest one other thing. I said 2 weeks ago in our frank talk from Scripture about immorality, how we just see America coming apart at the seams. I can't believe what I'm hearing on the news and seeing today as I look back 50 years ago and think, you wouldn't have even thought some of the things that are just accepted as normal conduct and just an alternative lifestyle. Young people having sex today is like having a cup of coffee. But God speaks specifically about that, and He knows how much that hurts them and is going to hurt their life. We're going to see tonight what the God who created us and created a woman uniquely and beautifully, and next week a husband uniquely and beautifully, we're going to see how He purposed to bring the two together and form a union between them that grows increasingly into what Scripture refers as oneness. And that's going to be our lesson 2 weeks from tonight. Next week, a husband's love, and the following week, oneness. How much of that do you see in America today? You don't even see that much in marriages that are still together. We had a young lady that Cheryl and I spent some time with, and she said, you know, before I knew you and Cheryl, I never thought there was a marriage that was happy. I said, what do you mean? She says, every marriage that I know in my family and extended family, the ones that are still together, and I'm quoting, she said, hate each other. I said, wait a minute. Be careful with your words. Do you mean hate? I mean hate each other. Everyone, everyone. We're talking about how God, the God of all creation, that created the beauty we see all around us. We're going to start seeing the spring flowers. I want you, as you start seeing the trees bud out, listen to this. I want you to do this in anticipation of tonight's lesson and the next three. As you see the trees budding out and you see flowers just poke up out of the ground that no man created, I want you to say to yourself, the same God that created that beauty intended for marriage to have that same beauty. And more. Why wouldn't he? Those are flowers. Those are trees. We're people that he loves. But how much of that do you see? And we don't see it because what we're going to talk about tonight is ridiculed and misunderstood. A wife's submission? Now, don't draw any conclusion until we finish tonight. But you just talk about the word submission. And you're going to see people well up with anger and God's ways are very different from man's ways. And man ridicules God's beautiful plan for a marriage where he brings two people together and they grow in love over the years instead of grow in anger and then separate and leave two kids with parents leaving separate. And they go their separate ways and then they get into what they call that hell of a term, and I'm not swearing, a blended marriage. Anybody that's experienced a blended marriage, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it, but knows it isn't perfect. We have blended marriages in our own family. And everybody that's in one will tell you it's far from perfect. But we put a beautiful name on it. When Cheryl and I first moved here to Coeur d'Alene 15 years ago, we heard a constant drumbeat from husbands. One after another, maybe, I didn't count them, but maybe half a dozen of them said it to me over the course of the first 3 or 4 months that I was teaching a Bible study over at Coeur d'Alene. They'd take me aside, they'd want to have dinner together, and Cheryl and I'd have dinner with the couple, but we'd slip aside and go to the men's room, and when he'd get me aside, he would say to me, Daryl, if you could get my wife to just submit to me, our marriage would be so much better. Constantly, that's what we heard. And I didn't let them know that I knew right then where the problem was. The Apostle Paul says in Romans 2:4, or do you think lightly of the riches of his, God's kindness and tolerance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of God leads you to repentance. Paul says clearly right here, God draws us to himself through his kindness, not through demands and authority. And we're going to see tonight and next week and the following week that God works in a marriage in exactly the same way, through a husband's kindness. Always. And let me say just before I read this to you couples that are middle-aged, been married a while and doing great, keep in mind tonight your kids. And as you listen to the lesson from God's Word and next week and the following, see if you want to give this set of CDs. You can get it, ask Penny afterwards. Just take your name down. If you want to pass them on to your kids. Maybe even some of your grandkids. I'm going to share with you tonight what God's Word says from Scripture, but I'm also going to share with you out of my 50 years of experience of being married. Things that have tested our marriage and where God has taken us. The only thing that's produced 50-year marriage between us. I'm going to share with you a collection of comments from people that we've counseled with over the years. Dozens. So keep your kids in mind. So let's read Ephesians chapter 5, verses 21 to 24, just for the context. Then we're going to come back tonight and consider just verse 21 and 22. Then go on from there next week. So just 21 through 24 tonight. Paul says, "And be subject to one another in the fear of Christ. Wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be subject to their husbands in everything." So Paul begins here by saying in verse 21, "And be subject to one another." Now first, there's some debate here among Bible scholars as to whether this verse is a conclusion to verses 18 to 20, or it's an introduction to Paul's discussion here of the marriage relationship in verses 22 through the remainder of this chapter, again, which we'll be considering over the next 4 weeks. However, in either case, it's important to note the first mention of the subject of submission is in reference to both a husband's and wife's submission to each other. It's right here. Paul again says, he begins this subject with, "And be subject to one another in the fear of Christ." So, for a husband to single out a wife's submission in verse 22 and talk about it independent from his own submission to her in verse 21 is to seriously distort what God's Word says. I never once heard one of those husbands that came to me saying, "You know, Daryl, I know God's Word says we're to submit to each other, and what does that mean?" All I heard was the drumbeat. If she just submit to me, if she just submit to me, she needs to submit to me. Well, further, to talk about a wife's submission independent from a husband's love, which again is our subject next week, majorly distorts God's Word. All of you have learned the importance when you're studying God's Word of understanding the context, the complete context, and not lifting one verse out independent of the context. The context begins with submission to each other. So then the word subject or submission means, here's what it means. For me to be subject to Cheryl and Cheryl to be subject or submissive to me means to yield to. For me to yield to her and her to yield to me. That's what it means. Or it means to give in to. Or it means to do what pleases her over what I want for myself. That's what it means. The antithesis of this word that's central to our discussion tonight, being subject to one another, is a demanding, selfish, authoritative, angry, or controlling spirit. That's the antithesis. Why can't you see it my way, Cheryl? I've come half the way, now I want you to do what I want. No, that's not God's word. That's not God's plan. That promises guaranteed divorce. Because it's not God's plan. So then, with both spouses desiring to please each other, having that heart to prefer the other to themselves, to listen to my wife, for her to listen to me, and for both of us to have a desire to want to do what the other prefers. Paul does go on and say, where that exists, he's recognizing that there can still be times where they can't agree, which should be rarely. If both are earnestly desiring to prefer the other to themselves, he goes on to say, however, with both of them desiring to prefer the other to themselves, where they can't agree in the final analysis, the wife should yield to her husband. And why? God had a glorious, merciful purpose for this. Verse 22 and 23. Wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. Paul first here is discussing God's peaceful order for all of life. Order. He says in verse 23, Christ is the head of the church, meaning Christ is the head of every believer. Then in verse 22, he says, wives are to be subject to their husbands. Then, according to Titus 3:1, in terms of God's continuing order, he tells us all of us are to be subject to or submissive to our government so that we continue to have order and we know God's order. He says children are to be subject to their parents. That's Ephesians 6:1. That will be three lessons from tonight. And we're going to talk about, in a way that kids understand, what it means for them to be respectful of their parents. Not because they agree with their parents, but that's a tremendous lesson for kids. Gives a whole new perspective to it from God. So Ephesians 6:1, concerning God's order, children come under their parents. And then still according to God's order in Ephesians chapter 6, 5 to 8, all employees God lays out according to His plan and His order are to be subject to their employers. So God laid it all out. Without this order, God knew we'd all just live in confusion and chaos. Someone needs to make a final decision where that's necessary. And in a marriage, that's the responsibility of a husband. But then secondly, it's important for us to realize God's peaceful order, in terms of our subject tonight, is out of His great love and compassion for wives, not out of relegating them to an inferior position. Or because God believes men are superior. Scripture says, in a verse I didn't bring tonight, the reference, we're all equal in Christ. None of us are lesser, male or female. We're all equal in Christ. But God gave this order out of His not only plan for order throughout life, as we've seen in regards to children, employees, etc., but also out of His love and compassion for wives. Paul goes on to say something uniquely that he says of no one else in verse 25, and we're going to consider this more in depth next week. He goes on to say in verse 25, husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave Himself up for her. Now, how much love is that? What did Christ do for the body of believers? What did He do? He took upon Himself all the sin and went to the cross. Took it all on Himself. The sin and the sacrifice. So that He could present us pure to God. Now you men try to think through, we'll get into this more next week. What kind of love is, how much love is that? Right here in verse 25, that's the love God desires and will grow in a husband that's seeking the Lord. Doesn't come from the world. You wouldn't hear any of this out there. But that's the love that God desires for a husband to have and the love that He grows in our lives towards our wives. A love that's to the extent that I'd set aside every preference I have and even physically die for Cheryl to protect her, to make her feel secure, to take care of her. So again, when husbands find themselves in that position where they have to make that rare decision where he and his wife can't agree, because remember, Paul started out, submit to each other. Paul says we should make it with love and preference. Love and preference for our wife's best interest. So what we really see is the husband shouldering the weight of decisions that are all in his wife's best interest. Decisions, again, that protect her. God gave us the shoulders to make those decisions, but never to make them selfishly. but to make those decisions as I listen to understand Cheryl and pray that God gives me the wisdom to understand this beautiful china plate that he brought into my cast iron skillet life. Ecclesiastes 9:9 says that the greatest earthly reward a man can experience is a wife that God gives him. Earthly reward. But we got to come back to this context. When my cast iron skillet is banging my wife's china plate around, she's going around 24/7 all shattered. How can she be that kind of reward to me when I shatter her day after day? Now, we'll talk about this more next week. Some years ago, Cheryl and I really wanted to have a fourth child. And we tried on several occasions, and Cheryl had two miscarriages. And when she went in to see the doctor for the second time, the doctor warned us both that if we tried again for a child and she miscarried again, it could threaten her life. She had to go in a week following that for some minor surgery, and the doctor said, I'll give you a form to take home and you can sign it, because while I'm doing this other minor surgery, I can prevent her from getting pregnant again, and if you choose to, protect her, the risk to her life. So we took it home and we talked about it. And every time I asked Cheryl, she says, I want another child. And I'm willing to take the risk. The day that we went into the hospital for the procedure, you know, they put you in a wheelchair even though you're perfectly healthy, and they put Cheryl in a wheelchair and took her back and put her in this gown that you put on before that surgery procedure, and then brought her back out to me and said she's going to be here for about 10 minutes and then we'll come get her. And the doctor says, have you signed that form yet? And I said, no, we haven't. He says, well, I'll need to have it signed when I pick her up, if that's what you want me to do. So I looked at Cheryl, and I said, what are you? Cheryl started crying. She says, I still want another child. I'm too emotional right now, but I want you to know I want another child, but I want you to make the decision. Three minutes after she said that, he came out and wheeled her away. And I said, can you give me two more minutes? I need God to make himself clearer. And what the Lord kept impressing on my heart was, as much as she wanted another baby, I couldn't feel right about her risking the possibility of not being able to continue to be the mother to the three kids we did have. And I signed the form in fear and trepidation. He took it back. They did the procedure. She came out. We had a week home together. I would go to work each day. We never mentioned it. I was fearful. We had our national convention a week later. It was in Phoenix, I believe. And we decided to stay a couple days over just for a little rest and relaxation. And I can remember, even though this was 35 years ago, I can remember the store we were looking through a day after the conference, just relaxing. And she was, it was an antique shop. And she was over there, and I'm standing back over here. She doesn't know it. And I'm praying, Lord, give me the strength to go up and talk to her about this. I don't know if she'll ever forgive me. I'm like 36, 37, whatever. And I come around the corner and I go over there and I say, Cheryl, yes? What are you looking at? Oh, this jar. Okay. Could I ask you something else? Well, yeah, I guess so. You know that procedure you had a week ago? Yeah. Well, did the doctor tell you what he did? Yeah. He did. He told you that I signed that form? Yeah. And you're not mad at me? No. Felt the weight of the world roll off my back. And I said, really? Why aren't you? And these are among some of the words she said to me I'll never forget. She said, Daryl, I knew that if I submitted a decision like this to you as God asked me to, he'd never allow you to make a mistake with my life. I asked Cheryl's permission to tell that story briefly. I got a little longer in it on the way down tonight because it's such a clear example of what we're talking about here and how God brought a man into a wife's life to make decisions that are in her best interest, that protect her, that defend her, that keep her out of harm's way. Well, I realize many wives live today with husbands who don't make decisions solely in their best interest. And God knew this would be true. So he gave several qualifications for a wife's submission. And I praise God for it because he's answered the questions that people have asked me through the years. Wives have asked me. And I want to consider in the context of four specific questions the clarification that God has given from his word. Four specific questions that wives have asked me over the years. First, I was asked by a wife some time ago, am I to submit to my husband even if he's asking me to do something wrong? For example, sign my name to a tax return I know is incorrect. Or lie about something. These are all things wives have asked me. Or act immorally in some way. Well, God gave an answer. Colossians 3:8, wives, be subject to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. The words as is fitting in the Lord mean a wife should submit to her husband so long as it is in keeping with God's word. Acts 5:29 says, but Peter and the apostles answered, we must obey God rather than men. So a wife shouldn't submit to her husband if he asks her to lie. Graciously, she should say, hubby, I'm going to be the best wife you've ever had, but God in me and my conscience won't allow me to do that. I can't do that. Doesn't mean I don't love you, but I can't do that. If he asks her to sign the tax return that she knows is inaccurate, she shouldn't sign it. And make the same gracious comment. She also shouldn't submit to some immoral request he makes, like watching pornography together. I've heard wives ask me this a number of times. This is what my husband wants me to do with him. Then second, I've been asked, what if my husband forbids me to go to church or to some Bible study or to a fellowship group? Hebrews 10, 24 to 25 again say, and let us consider, how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds. And here's how that happens. Not forsaking our own, that's believers, assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Paul says here, our fellowship with other Christians is so critical to our spiritual growth, it shouldn't be prevented by anyone. Now, this doesn't mean that the Holy Spirit in us that teaches us all things, according to John 14, 26, wouldn't lead a wife to stay home from going to a church to care for an ill spouse or for some other reason. In that case, because God knows the importance of spiritual fellowship, He will provide her with the fellowship of other Christians in some other way. For example, meeting another believer over lunch. I know of several examples where this happens. Wives are unable to go to the regular church on Sunday, but God miraculously provides that fellowship to her in a different way. Especially for you younger people here. I want you to note here how important God says here Christian friends are. He says they're essential. And how important it is to stay away from those who influence us away from God's way of life. 1 Corinthians 15, 13 says these words, and I'm quoting, bad company corrupts good people. Now, how straight is that? Now, why do you hear some energy in my voice? Because I've lived for 71 years, and I see people every day, and I see bad company. They're my friend. Bad company corrupts good people. There's no exception. It's God's word. It can't fail. What God says is true. It will happen. Then I want to bring another verse to bear on this subject. First Corinthians 7, 12 to 13. Paul says there, but to the rest I say, not the Lord, that if any brother has a wife, and it's important to note the structure and word, specific words here. If any brother refers to a Christian. If any Christian has a wife who is an unbeliever, and she consents to live with him, he must not divorce her. And a woman who has an unbelieving husband, and he consents to live with her, she must not send her husband away. Paul, I believe here, is establishing that the rule of the home be what Scripture says. Notice he says in verse 12, if she, referring to the unbeliever, consents to live with him, the believer, Then again in verse 13, if an unbelieving husband consents to live with her, the believer. In both cases, Paul makes the unbeliever consenting to live with the believer the condition. So it's clear to me from this scripture, the believer's spiritual convictions take precedent over the unbeliever. Where you have a believer and an unbeliever living together in the same home, married, which is often the case. I've been presented with this question often. I can remember a wife years ago coming to me with tears. And this is why it's so important for young people to marry someone they know has God in their heart. That's why Scripture says don't be unequally yoked. Because with God in the husband's life and God in the wife's life, that God in both of them is going to continually attract them to His Word and Himself. No exception. It's God doing it. Wife doesn't have to beat her husband over the head, and the husband doesn't have to try to corral his wife. But it's God doing it. He that hath begun a good work in both of them will continue it. Philippians 1:6. Sure, probably remembers this one lady. I remember it because it was so agonizing. Her husband was a nice guy, but he didn't want the kids to go to church. He didn't want them to have anything to do with the Lord. He wanted to take them golfing on Sunday, and she wanted to take them to church. And she'd come to a sweeping. He keeps wanting to do this, and I feel strongly I want my kids to grow up knowing the Lord that I know. We've seen that many times. We told her just what Scripture says here. You need to graciously tell your husband that this is what God has put in your heart, and you ask him to respect this because it's of God. And if he can't respect, you can live with him and love him. But if he can't respect the God that's in you and the convictions that he gives you for your life and your family, then he has to think about leaving. Well, third, I've been asked, am I supposed to have, this pretty common one, Daryl, a physical relationship with my husband if he's being totally insensitive to me and to the kids? And if so, how can I make myself do that when he turns me off completely? God tells me to be submissive, but how can I be submissive in that way when he's so, in many ways, disrespectful of me? And he doesn't spend any time with the kids. And that hurts me. Well, chapter 5 again, verse 21 says, and be subject to one another in the fear of Christ. The NIV translation and the Berkeley translation both read, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Paul knew there would be many times when wives wouldn't feel like submitting physically to their husbands. So he said, wives, be submissive, not because your husband deserves it, but because Christ does. So I've encouraged many wives, the next time submitting feels difficult, try remembering the Lord says, this is how you show reverence to me. Then fourth, I've been asked, how can I submit to my husband if I don't respect his judgment and decisions? Another pretty common one. And I'm not referring here to moral issues, as we've already covered them, but to matters primarily related to family finances. And I always take that dear wife to God's word because it can't fail. I praise God for giving me his word, because it's not, my words aren't worth anything. But whenever I share God's word with that dear wife in tears, usually discussing these things with Cheryl and I'm sharing what I know can't fail. Can't fail. And I love to take them to Psalm 34:10. The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they who seek the Lord shall not be in want of any good thing. So God says here, anyone who trusts the Lord won't miss out on any good thing. So, praise the Lord. How many times my spirit has praised the Lord as I've realized a submissive wife's financial well-being doesn't depend on her husband's wisdom or good judgment, but on God miraculously taking care of her and her family. God said, she won't miss out on any good thing. That's my promise to her. And I'm the How Great Thou Art God. And I have the ability to accomplish that and make sure that never fails. I have to tell you, in the Christianity that I grew up in, I heard as well pretty much a cold, calloused, legalistic, wives need to submit to their husbands. I praise God that he brought me to this study for the first time about 40 years ago and has brought me back to it probably 10 or 12 times since then. And each time I see God's mercy and grace and glory in this study and the beauty in the way he created a man and a woman and purpose to bring them together where they do truly experience in their life and their kids see it in their home. The beauty that you see shortly when those spring blossoms begin to appear. Not that we don't have troubles. Not that we don't have difficult times in our marriage. We do. But a big part of God's beauty is for our kids to see what we do when we can't agree and we have difficulty. Our kids see us praying. They hear us talk about praying. And they see the Spirit of God work through those difficulties in our life and unite us. And that becomes a legacy for our own kids, then for the grandkids. Everything God created, it's gloriously beautiful. And marriage was no exception. Next week, a husband's love for his wife. A lot of new comments in that, that God's brought to me from Scripture. What that love really means. The next week, how two become one. How God grows them to where increasingly they feel like they're operating as one. not two at odds. The following week, children's respect for their parents. I praise God. See you next week.